promise I won't continue this torture for too long. So this is a very generic topic, right? PAD. Everyone sees PAD. Everyone knows PAD. Everyone wants to take care of patients with PAD. And you will, in your practice, will most probably have a lot of patients with PAD, either underlying, which you might diagnose, or hopefully they'll come to you with some complaint. So PAD, essentially, I say calcium here, calcium there, calcium everywhere, right? You have atherosclerosis somewhere, you've got atherosclerosis everywhere. What we worry about as vascular surgeons is what people come with, extremity PAD. It's reduction of blood flow to extremities, secondary to reduction in luminal diameter of the artery caused by buildup of atherosclerotic plaque. And so it could happen anywhere and everywhere, also called PVD, which we don't use anymore. It used to be called PAOD. I think we were too lazy to have that O, so we took the O out. So the problem is it affects a lot of people, right? So about 10 to 12 million people, secondary only to CAD, which is y'all's area. And then for every 4 patients with CAD, a physician might expect to see 3 patients with PAD. So there will be underlying PAD issues in all the patients that you see. And there are underlying many more CAD issues than the patients that we see. Risk of PAD, one is just age, just increasing age is the biggest risk factor. Males is the second risk factor. So I'm getting old, I'm a male, it's getting scary. Family history, alcohol use, BMI, those are all smaller factors, but predominantly these are the familial risk factors. More than 70 years, much higher risk of PAD. 50 to 69 years and history of smoking or diabetes makes you high risk, even though you're not advanced age, and less than 50 years with diabetes and then other atherosclerosis risk factors, so hyperlipidemia, familial history, etc. The diabetes actually puts people at 4 times a higher risk of developing PAD in the general population, and these people are 4 times more difficult to treat and maintain because their rate of atherosclerosis is also much higher. Who should we screen for PAD? That's one question that always comes up. Is anyone less than 50 years with diabetes and one more risk factor? Anyone with 50 to 69 with a history of smoking and diabetes? And then age 70 or older with just age and no risk factors. But then if you have a known CAD, carotid or renal disease, then you should screen them for PAD as well, regardless of what their age is. And if you have a known history of claudication or they have non-healing wounds on the feet, then they have PAD. It's not screening anymore. It's going to be a diagnosis, right? But that's what they bring in. 50% of them are asymptomatic, and that's why I keep saying there will be an undercurrent of PAD in your practice that you would see. A small portion come with critical limb ischemia. That's the cold leg and cold hand that we see. 15% will have claudication, and then there's 1/3 which will have atypical leg pain. So don't dismiss them off. At the same time, don't go overboard testing them, but they will have non-classic pain there. Also, intermittent claudication, which is a pain in a muscle or a group of muscles due to ischemia, which is exacerbated by exercise and relieved by rest, which is duplicated every single time. That is the classic definition. There are 12 million people affected by PAD. They are, a lot of them are not claudicants, 50%, but there are 6 million of them who still are. The claudication actually is based very classically on where your obstruction is. So if you have an aortoiliac occlusive disease, you probably will have buttock claudication or erectile dysfunction. If you have a common femoral or profundofemoral disease, you will probably have thigh and calf claudication. And if you have superficial femoral disease, usually claudication is restricted to below the knee. So a good history can also tell you. Critical limb ischemia, which is ischemic rest pain or any ulcer, or gangrene, a symptom duration of more than 2 weeks. Then acute limb ischemia, which is the classic cold leg. They come with the classic 5 P's that we learned in medical school, which no one looks for anyways. But it's usually pulselessness and the pallor, the paresthesia. Paresthesia is very classic, and you have to elicit that because that's the first sign that comes in. Nerves are much more sensitive than the skin. The key component of a vascular exam is make sure the patient is undressed from, well, if you're looking at lower extremity, from the hip down, I mean, of course, wear underwear, but have at least don't wear the like pair of jeans with boots on like we have patients walking into our clinic. We always give them those disposable shorts. Some actually like them. But anyway, so make sure the footwear is off. Make sure you examine their feet. Make sure you do a thorough exam, right? Bilateral arm blood pressure is critical because when we do ABIs, sometimes people have subclavian artery stenosis on the left, which is more common on the left, and they have a lower blood pressure on one side. So then your ABI, maybe if they take only one arm, then your ABI is not correct. And so always measure bilateral pressures. Auscultate their heart, we never do it. Palpate the belly for aneurysmal disease, but our patients with a BMI of 35, it's impossible to palpate anything. Auscultate for bruise, especially carotid bruise, and then examine the feet for pallor or signs. The pulse exam, a general pulse exam, and remember this, that if you have a patient with PAD, with significant PAD, and elevate their leg at 60 degrees for about a minute, and then you put them down, the normal color should come back within 10 to 15 seconds. If it takes too close to a minute, then yes, it indicates severe PAD. But going by family feud, the average clinic time is about 12 minutes, so maybe this is going to add to the effort, but this is just a good clinical finding to at least keep in mind if you have the time. ABIs, I know everyone knows ABIs, but it's the higher blood, how do you go back? Okay, never mind. Take blood pressure on both arms. The higher blood pressure is what you want as the brachial, and then the ankle is on both sides. So take the higher brachial pressure, right or left, and then measure both ankle pressure, so ankle brachial index. 1.3 to 0.91 is normal. 0.90 is abnormal. Remember that. So please don't think that 0.9 means normal. So 0.90 means abnormal. So think about exercise-induced ABIs and those kind of situations. When we do segmental pressures, we see triphasic waveforms, and then those triphasic waveforms become monophasic. You know, as the waveform changes, the clue is the disease is between that portion. So if you have triphasic at the common femoral and you have monophasic at the popliteal, your disease is somewhere in between. If the waveform changes between the popliteal and the tibial, then the disease is in between that segment. That's a clue. Symptomatic patients require revascularization. Asymptomatic patients require TLC. Don't go treating asymptomatic disease. So I always tell, I tell myself first, and then I tell my trainees that don't treat the image, always treat the patient, because treat their symptoms first. You cannot make better, more better. Remember this. On a CT angio or a conventional angio or a duplex, et cetera. So these are various imaging that we have at our disposal. Arterial duplex is great for follow-ups, mainly for after interventions, not so much as your primary study, but it could be useful in diabetics because ABIs are non, you know, the vessels are non-compressible, so the ABIs are falsely elevated. CTA gives you a great information about calcium, about occlusions. MRA obviously negates the use of contrast, but doesn't give you any information about calcium. The angiogram is the gold standard, both diagnostic and therapeutic. For symptomatic patients, always have a multidisciplinary team, involve the hyperlipidemia expert. We always involve the primary care and the cardiologist if we can. The initial part for claudication, initial treatment for claudication without any ulcers is smoking cessation, a structured exercise program, and then medication. Medication could be the rheolytic agent, so I'll come to that in a minute. Make sure their sugars are under control, and we always recommend against doing any invasive procedures on them. Medical management by statins, so that's a little old now, but still the basic treatment is the same. Bring their LDL down, make sure the blood pressure is controlled, make sure their A1C is good. And then antiplatelet regime is typically, you don't need dual antiplatelets unless you intervene. Typically aspirin is what's recommended. So the the level 1A evidence is antiplatelet agents to reduce the risk of MI, CVA, so associated cardiopulmonary morbidity with PAD. So that's definitely recommended. Plavix could be an alternative, but we don't recommend dual antiplatelet therapy. And warfarin has no benefit really, unless you cannot give anything else to them. Revascularization, everyone knows about angiograms, angioplasty, stenting, etc. Typically, remember that treat the physiologically significant segment. Not every single stenosis has to be treated. Treat the inflow first. So if you have high-grade iliac stenosis and some SFA disease, don't try and stent everything. At least treat the inflow first and see how they do. Sometimes patients improve with that. Unless you have an ulcer distal, then you need inline flow. But if you're doing it for severe claudication, think about treating inflow first. You all know this, lots of devices, lots of fun techniques. We know this, thankfully, lots of fun grafts, lots of places to cut and sew. So an iliac disease requires an aorta bifem. Unilateral iliac disease, kind of iliofem. Unilateral iliac disease, if it's a hostile abdomen, someone has a colostomy coming in, radiation to the belly, then we avoid that, do a fem-fem crossover. And then people who absolutely cannot undergo a haircut without getting an MI, we do an axillary bifem for those people. Amputation is something we want to avoid, of course. We like to call ourselves limb salvage guys, so and so will you all when we do interventional stuff. The level is decided by the inflow. So if you have bad inflow, you will have a higher level of amputation. The problem is, I tell my patients, patients come and tell me is, if I get an amputation, I'm going to die. I said, no. If you get an amputation, you have bad disease that's going to kill you down the line. It's not the amputation that's going to kill you. So remember that the higher the rate of, higher the level of amputation, worse is the disease process that's already going on in them. A few words about the cold leg that we see. It's an emergency. The goal of care is limit the ischemia time to less than 6 hours, because after that, muscle necrosis sets in. Remember to resuscitate these people. Don't forget the IV fluid resuscitation. Don't forget getting good lines, et cetera, in them. If you have the luxury of getting a CT angio, it can help for aortoiliac disease. But if you have a strong femoral pulse and everything is below, don't. Just go to the operating room is what we say. So in general, asymptomatic disease, ABI, is actually more than 9. It's less than 9, but they are asymptomatic. You don't do anything. Even though the ABI is abnormal, they aren't symptomatic. If they have mild disease, intermittent claudication, non-operative management is the first thing. If you have moderate to severe disease, if you have lifestyle-limiting claudication, then yes, consider some kind of intervention. If you have critical limb ischemia, do not consider no intervention. Please consider intervention. And then and make sure they're medically optimized. Statins, glucose control, blood pressure control. So summary is, this is under-recognized. You need a thorough history and physical exam. Get rest and exercise ABIs as the first step. Risk factor modification to prevent adverse cardiovascular events. And then drug therapy, selective use of revascularization as what the patient needs. And then it does include multiple endovascular versus surgical options to prevent an amputation. So thank you.